Well, I'm delighted to introduce our next speaker, me. I didn't realize that everybody was going to start with some sort of anecdote about Dan. It would take me years to even begin to cull them from the 25 years of palling around that we've done. But I, seeing Bill Swan today was reminding me of when I first met Dan. In 1985, I got a job at the University of Texas, and Bill Swan did two very important things for me. One, he became a dear friend and mentor, which he remains to this day. The other is, about a month after getting there, he said, you know, you ought to meet this guy who lives in San Antonio named Dan Wegner. I said, why? He said, well, you're both named Dan, you're both fat, and you both smoke too much. Bill has always been known as a diplomat. So Dan Wegner's scheduled to come up and see his friends in Austin, and indeed he did. And I just can't forget, the guy walks into my office, he says, hi, I'm Dan. I said, oh, hi, I'm Dan. He looks around. He says, oh, you're still moving in? Because he's looking at these boxes of data that I keep under a table. I said, no, I'm not just moving in. These are here. He looked. He said, well, they look a lot better over there. I thought, what kind of clown is this guy? Well, in the 25 years since, I have answered that question. I know what kind of clown he is. Now, the reason I'm telling you the story is because I've told this story often when people say, how did you first meet Dan Wegner? And every time I tell it, you would think, Wegner is often there when I tell it, you would think he'd go, oh my God, I can't believe I said that. What he actually says is, they would have looked better over there. I was right. There is no admitting the man was wrong. Which is what I want to talk about today. So, if you live in the company of human beings for very long, you learn three important facts about them. One is they sometimes do bad things. Two is they sometimes admit to doing bad things. And three is the first number is a great deal larger than the second number. And so the question is, when is it that people admit to having transgressed? And that's what I want to talk about today, some research that Bethany Burum and I have been doing together on the ironic effects of incriminating evidence. Now, there are two basic laws about when people will admit guilt, neither of them particularly controversial, both easy to demonstrate. Here's the first. Let's try a little demonstration. How many people here, please do raise your hands if this describes you, how many people here have at one time or another ignored their partner's needs and been selfishly attentive to their own? Okay, so a bunch of you. Yes, and question number two, how many of you have cheated on your partner? So, either you are the most monogamous group of humans who's ever been assembled, or you are demonstrating the first law of admitting guilt, which is we admit guilt when transgressions are minor, and we are less likely to do so when they're major. Okay, the second law of admitting to transgressions, admitting guilt, is also easy to demonstrate. Here's two quotes from President Clinton. The first from January 98, I did not have sexual relations with that woman, Miss Lewinsky, as he wagged his finger at us. 8 months later, I did have a relationship with Miss Lewinsky that was not appropriate. So what in the world happened between those two dates that allowed Bill Clinton to change his mind about what he did? Well, a little blue dress. In other words, evidence. It is more like we're more likely to admit to transgressions when there's evidence we did it than when there isn't. Now, neither of these facts is particularly interesting, and neither is particularly controversial, but it turns out that when you bring them together, there is an interesting irony, and that's what I want to tell you about today. Here's how the irony happens. Bill Clinton illustrates, but it did not take Bill Clinton for psychologists to know that human beings minimize their transgressions. Here's Bill's famous, here is President Clinton's, here is President Clinton's famous quote. You remember, he told his aides, he said he was not having a sexual relationship with Monica Lewinsky, and here he explains, well, it was true, meaning we weren't actually engaged in intercourse when the question was asked, right? It was in the present tense. That's actually what he's claiming here. I didn't really lie, because, you know, from the story became, it wasn't the sex, it was the lie that was the transgression. What he's saying here was, it really wasn't much of a lie. Well, this tortured logic is a great example of how what most of us do maybe just not so well. which is we somehow minimize what we've done wrong. You know, somehow it wasn't as bad as it originally seemed. Now, the second fact is that evidence can inhibit this process of minimization. This is a famous billboard, a real billboard. This is a New York Times photo, not a doctored one. Hi, Stephen, do I have your attention now? I know all about her, you dirty, sneaky, immoral, unfaithful, poorly endowed slimeball. Everything's caught on tape. Your soon-to-be ex-wife, Emily. P.S. I paid for this billboard from our joint bank account. Now, this billboard is going to make it very hard for Stephen to say, it wasn't a big deal, I didn't really do it, right? Now, the fact is that when other people have evidence about us, our behavior goes from something being something we know to something that is in the social world. And as a result, it becomes less fluid. It's almost like a phase state transition. Our own behaviors, things we know about, are like gas. And when others know about them, they solidify. It's very easy for me to kind of conveniently misremember exactly what I was thinking or what I did when nobody knows what I did. But once it becomes public knowledge, it's pretty important that we remember accurately what it is we know and that others know, and so it becomes difficult to minimize our transgressions. Once information is shared, that can be what happens. Now, you can see how these two things can go together, because if evidence makes it hard for us to minimize, it means that our major transgressions stay major rather than becoming minor, which means that we're less likely to want to admit to them, and hence the counterintuitive prediction that evidence can, on some occasions, and I'll show you when, decrease the likelihood of somebody admitting that they did the very thing for which there is evidence. Yes, that was like hours of PowerPointing to get that damn thing to work. And I'll never get to use it again. Okay, now how would you test this prediction that when people are confronted with evidence, under certain circumstances, they are more likely to deny than when they are not confronted? Well, we began with the assumption that we must, in our laboratory, make subjects do something shameful. Second, we must either tell or not tell them that we have evidence of what they did. And our prediction was that when confronted with this evidence, they would be more likely rather than less likely to deny it. So how did we actually execute this plan? Well, we started the way any good social psychologist would. We made a porn film. I should say Bethany made a porn film while I cleared all the men out of the lab. Now, this film actually is a film, I'm showing you just a snippet here, of a woman in a changing room, an attractive young woman trying on three different bikinis. Because of Bethany's artful positioning of camera and mirror and the fantastic acting of Lady Stariel, you will never see any nudity in the film, but there is the constant potential for nudity, the constant promise of nudity. And what I can tell you about this film is that if you show it to young men, they find it moderately arousing. She's attractive, and she keeps dressing and undressing, and they like looking at it, and they find it pretty arousing. Okay. Now, how do you make being aroused shameful? Well, the way we did it was we told men in our experiment that this film had been taken by a hidden camera planted by a peeping Tom in a boutique's dressing room. And you can see Stariel in the upper, your upper right. You can see at the end of the film she's trying on her last bathing suit when suddenly she looks in the mirror and sees the camera in back of her, gets this horrified look on her face, and runs out of the dressing room. To make matters even worse, we told them, you're going to read that, so I'm going to tell you, we told them that the Peeping Tom had uploaded this film to a website where Peeping Toms upload their films called caughtoncam.com. And other creepy guys could watch it and leave comments about it. Furthermore, the woman in the video found out that her video was up there on the web. And this is the comment she left on the website. I know many of you think this is just another hot video, but I'm a real person. It was so disgusting when I realized that some creep was taping me the whole time I was in the dressing room. Then he posted the footage for everyone I know to see, including my dad and brother and all my friends. It was all over school. I've never felt so humiliated. I can't be in a changing room or even my own bedroom without worrying that some perv is spying on me. So all you watching and commenting on my hot rack, should really think about the real people who get hurt when assholes post videos like this. Okay. What we attempted to do here, and I hope you will agree, is create a sexually arousing film that anybody, any right-minded straight male, should feel horribly ashamed of being aroused seeing, because this film did great damage to the young woman in it. Now, we showed people in an experiment this film, and we had two conditions that I'm going to tell you about. In the first condition, they watch this film, the invasion of privacy film. Then they do a filler task in which, for 10 minutes, they judge the attractiveness of Chinese characters, and then they tell us how sexually aroused they were when they were watching the video. In another condition of the experiment, we do exactly the same thing, except we add one little bit, which is after they watch the invasion of privacy video, we tell them there was a hidden camera in their room, and it's a special camera that was monitoring their pupillary dilation, and a research assistant in the other room was watching their eyelid, their pupils the entire time, and knew, because pupillary dilation tells psychologists this sort of thing, exactly how aroused they were. So in other words, we created two conditions, one in which men watched this film, which was shamefully arousing, and there was no evidence that they were aroused, and one in which there was evidence. Here's the question. When we asked them to confess to their own level of arousal, who said they felt most aroused? Well, you can imagine from the title of the talk that actually the people who were told that their arousal was measured denied being aroused. People who knew that somebody had actually been watching them. People in the other condition were more likely to say, yeah, I guess it was a little bit hot. Now, one possibility, our interpretation of this, our preferred interpretation of this effect, is that when men were told they were monitored, this made it very hard for them to minimize the transgression of feeling aroused. My gosh, somebody knows about it. I can't really fool myself anymore. But that makes it a really terrible thing, and so they have a greater incentive to deny. Now, if that's true, then it isn't just the existence of evidence that should create this effect I've just shown you, this tendency to deny. It's the existence and the timing of the evidence. That is, because these men were told that they were monitored right after watching the film, they didn't have time to minimize their transgression. So what if we told them they were being monitored a little after they watched the film? That's exactly what we did. In another condition of the experiment, we did exactly the same thing as we did in the condition I just showed you, the immediate evidence condition, except we switched the order of two elements. Men in the delayed evidence condition watched the film, did a filler task, and were then told that their arousal had been monitored before they were asked how aroused they were. And what we found was that men in the delayed evidence condition were just as willing to admit that they were aroused as men in the no evidence condition. It's only when confronted immediately with evidence that people seem to say, no, it wasn't me. I didn't do the bad thing. Now, this is obviously one experiment. Actually, it's been replicated, and we're doing more and extending it, so I don't want to hang too much on a little bit of data. But it is, to my knowledge, the only theory that explains something we see all the time, which is the odd fact that when people are caught red-handed, in our experiment, red-minded, they deny having done what it's obvious they did. These are clips from a very famous Woody Allen film. Anybody over 40 remembers this. Everything you always want to know about sex, but were afraid to ask. In this film, Gene Wilder is a psychiatrist, and he falls in love with a sheep. And I'm going to show you the clip where his wife breaks into the hotel room.
Anne, wait a minute, I can explain. We're just friends.
How are you?
This is Mrs. Bancourt, one of my patients. She thinks she's a sheep. Stuff awful. There's nothing to it.
She thinks she's a sheep. You've got it all wrong. There's nothing to it. And what makes it funny is he's denying what's obvious. We think this is funny that because he's denying something in the face of evidence. But what our experiment suggests is he's denying because of the evidence, not just in spite of it. So our theory does, I think, explain conditions like this. It's a little hard to say, obviously, if our interpretation of these data is the right one, but they do suggest that people should be more willing to admit to doing, you know, something bad after a long time has passed than they would right away. We don't know if that's true, but we're doing further studies to investigate. Thank you.